The producers of this podcast would like to remind you that we're providing general financial advice only. If you're looking for personal financial advice or before you make any investment decisions, please consult a professional financial advisor. Countdown!
Batteries to power.
Welcome back to QAV Seafood. How are you today?
Good. Good. You know I don't like seafood, don't you?
Really? The name or the cuisine?
No, I don't care. Don't care about the name. I'm not a big seafood eater.
Well, good thing you're not on the Mediterranean diet like I am, mate, because it's mostly seafood.
Is it?
Yeah.
I kind of am, but I do have red meat instead of seafood. Lots of veggies, nuts, and fruit.
I'm on the Mediterranean diet, but I just replaced all the fruit and vegetables with candy and all of the seafood with red meat. But apart from that...
You can eat red meat on the Mediterranean diet, and I have lots of fruit and veg.
A very little red meat you're supposed to eat. Like, it's supposed to be a treat, like maybe once a week, once a fortnight, something like that is my understanding of it.
Okay. Well, I'm on the modified Mediterranean diet.
I have salmon probably, like a piece of salmon for dinner once or twice a week, and then I have smoked salmon bagels for lunch a couple of times a week, a little bit of tinned tuna, scallops
once a week. Yuck. I just remember growing up with tinned fish, and it just made me sick every time I had it.
Oh, well.
I don't mind. I don't mind fresh salmon on bagels when it comes that thinly sliced stuff. That's good. We had that for the
fresh
weekend.
Fresh or smoked?
Smoked is fine as long as it's good quality.
Yeah.
So we had that for the weekend for lunch one day too. But most seafood I don't like.
Bit of cream cheese, you know, a little bit of some capers, a little bit of dill. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's good.
No, that's nice. I agree.
Well, I'm like you. I've never been a big fan of seafood. I think it's growing up in Queensland that did it to me. But it was just the amount of seafood that we ate as a kid.
Yeah.
Put like the smell of seafood on my fingers all the time, and I kind of got sick of that. But
I can't walk into a seafood section of a supermarket now without getting sick.
It's disgusting, right? Yeah, I remember walking through the Vic Markets in Melbourne, and the seafood section, I'd have to hold my breath and walk quickly too.
Yeah, same.
But these days I'm into it more than I have been in the past. How are you doing? Week, what is this, 27 of lockdown for you, 28?
13.
Are you feeling like that 27. Your rights are being oppressed, Tony? Are you feeling revolutionary? Are you putting on your Che Guevara cap and getting ready to march in the streets?
None of those, no. My rights are being oppressed to the extent that if I don't like the government, I can't leave and go somewhere else that has a better government. But that's probably it.
You can leave.
Can you?
Well, where do you want to go? To a different state or a different country?
Different state at this stage. You can see my daughter.
I think you
That's the biggest. That's the biggest thing for me is just being away from people. People that you love. Can't see Alex. Can't see Jenny's father, who's 87 or 88. What a terrible way to end a good life. Just stuck in a one-bedroom apartment in a nursing home.
Sucks, man. And, it's not fair.
And I think, you know, I just get sick of the messaging and the spin the politicians keep throwing at us every day.
I love
listening to the epidemiologists. They tell it like it is. You know, they're matter of fact. We'll get to 3,000 cases a day. No worries. Of course it'll be like that. And the hospitals will be full to overflowing. So, maybe we won't get out of lockdown
when we
reach 80%.
That's your problem. You can't listen to the epidemiologists. They're all being paid by Bill Gates to put chips in your head, Tony. You've got to listen to Fox News. That's where you're going to get the real facts from. Don't listen to scientists. What do they know?
Sky News at night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
We've
just upset all of our Australian readers, the readers of The Australian who listen to the show. Sorry about that.
Well, here's a question. If a newspaper hasn't made a cent profit in the last, 50 years since it's been going, why does it exist?
So it's for political influence.
It's propaganda, isn't it?
Yeah. Hmm. Anywho.
Yep.
Speaking of things that aren't making any money, let's talk about stocks. I'm kidding. COG, Tony, is it Cogstate or is it something else?
No, it's Cog Financial. So someone pointed out when I spoke about it last week, I used both companies interchangeably, and that was a mistake. It's COG, COG Financial. There is another one called COG State, which I wasn't talking about.
Even though you kept saying COG State, yeah. And I didn't know that there was two companies. I just thought it was all the same thing, so I let it go.
Yeah, sorry about that. And just a further clarification on that too. The I spoke last week about some of the issues with the write-down. There's a write-down issue and there was something else from memory, which may lead to a qualified audit, but the audit's now out and it's unqualified. So the auditors are happy with the write-downs and with the other issue, which from memory was a valuation issue, I think. No, sorry, it was a question mark over going concern because the part of COG, not COGSTAT, COG Financial, that lends money to businesses has lots of short-term liabilities, but they're matched against long-term assets. And so strictly speaking, there was a question about whether COG Financial could pay its bills this year and keep going as a going concern. But the auditors haven't raised any emphasis of matter on that. They have put both things into the key audit matters, but it's not a qualified audit.
Right. Okay. Good to go. Yeah. How are they doing, COG? Are they having a good run?
Yeah,
I think so. About them? You didn't put the kibosh on them?
Let me have a look. Well, I don't think I did a pull apart on COG, or did I?
I think you did. That's what this was all about, wasn't it?
Someone asked the question about the impairments. No, they're doing well. Oh, I can't recall whether it was a pull apart or not, but they're doing well.
It was.
You're right. Sorry. Yes.
It was your pork fork last week. Yeah.
It was. You're right. Sorry. So did you buy them?
I already own them, which is why I didn't want you to talk about them.
Our curses are lifted.
Well, it went from $1.51 down to $1.44, but it's back up to $1.48. So our curse is half lifted, let's say that. It's half a curse.
Half a curse is better than a full curse.
So you got some results of a new trial on positive operating cash flow?
Yeah, so must have been around this time last year. I had a musing about whether if a company went from a negative operating cash flow to a positive operating cash flow, whether that was a good sign that the share price would outperform that following that. And I did some analysis and used the QAV stocks from August last year and then again from February, so the half-year reports in February. And the results are mixed. So just to summarise them, there were great results from August last year. The stocks were up 109% that went from negative to positive operating cash flow. But from February, the six-month figures were only up 3% for those stocks that went from negative to positive. So my guess is that this is maybe something coming out of the COVID cough that we saw a lot of stocks maybe go from negative to positive cash flow or as part of the recovery in stocks generally that the ASX had as well, the index had as well, from last year to this year. So I'm not convinced it's statistically valid to progress any further.
Right.
I know it's only a sample of two halves, but if it was clear cut, I'd keep going, but I'm not.
Right. Okay. Tell me about Appendix 4E, Tony.
Yeah, so I've been trying to find a place where a qualified audit is recorded, and it doesn't always happen, but in Appendix 4E, there is a section. So Appendix 4E is the return that comes out with the annual numbers, with the annual figures to the ASX, and it gives a quick summary of it, like a one-page. Give me a one-page summary of it, and it gives like a snapshot of key information. So it gives the dividends, the net tangible assets, probably gives the earnings per share, about 12 different things in a summary form. And one of the last thing it asks for is it has a question that the ASX wants to know about. Are the company figures audited, and was there any qualification to it? So it's there. However, and that's where I go to first now if I want to try and see if it's a qualified audit. However, some companies just blandly say something like the financials have been audited, and they don't go on to say what the status of the audit is. better companies will say the company's figures have now been audited and the audit has no qualifications.
And is this something that's published separately to the annual report? So if you look in the list of documents that they've published in Stock Doctor, this will be broken out?
Yes, you'll see. Sometimes it's with the financials, but it'll say like annual financials and Appendix 4E, or sometimes it might just say Appendix 4E. Sometimes it says Appendix 4E and preliminary financials, preliminary being unaudited. So you'll see that as part of 4E, it'll say the numbers are still being audited. And that's another issue that's cropped up just in the last couple of weeks with downloads I've been doing, is that apparently the ASX has given a waiver for the requirement to have their annual numbers audited by the end of August. And I think that was something that was loosened during COVID because it was difficult getting auditors out to companies and things like that. So I had to do visits and check things. And that's still in force. So there's been a couple of companies that I've checked recently that don't yet have audited figures.
Right.
Yeah. So when I've been filling out the manually entered data sheet, I've been saying if they were audited last half and it was clean, I've still said qualified audit no, rather than leaving it blank, because that would take it off the buy list straight away.
Yeah.
But there may be some cases we should go back and check before we buy or sell stocks.
Right. Moving right along, GLE's results are out.
Yes.
Good old GLE.
I just raise it because it hasn't come through on my download because the ADT, the average daily transactions, is zero.
Yeah.
Even though the price has risen since the results came out.
Right.
But it's still 32 cents, which I think was below its high point, which was about 37.
Below what I sold it for too, which was 33 cents,
oh.
I think.
Oh, good. Okay.
Yeah. I got out just in time before it collapsed another 10 or 15%. Then it came back up, as you say. I did get an alert from Hot Copper, I think, the other day, saying that they had one of the directors, I think, had sold a bunch of stock, 55 million shares or something.
Okay.
Some major shareholder movements there, and I thought, oh no, don't tell me the share price has bumped up and I should have held on to it, but so far it's all good.
Yeah. I just raise it in case people wonder why it wasn't on the buy list anymore, but that was the reason.
Yeah. Speaking of the buy list, by the time people hear this, we will have put one out. Our first official scorecard.
Yes. Looking forward to that again. Yeah, so we're going to put it out. It'll go out with an email, I think, in the email to people with the recording, won't it? That's the plan?
In an email in with the recording?
Email, is that right? Sorry?
Yeah, so it'll go out every Monday in the weekly email. The podcast this week's doesn't normally come out till Tuesday, so they'll get the email with the previous week's podcast. For the people who miss it, they'll get the email saying, hey, this was last week's podcast and all the stuff we talked about. And then this week's episode comes out the following day, usually.
Okay. And the email that goes out will have the buy list in it, though, right?
Yes.
For our subscribers, yes.
It'll go out on a Monday, yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
About lunchtime.
Yeah, good. Good, yeah. So buy list is ready to go.
Yeah. Now, the one that we're putting out this week, we filtered out stocks with zero ADT and stocks that are tied to an underlying commodity that's price is in decline. So our iron ore stocks and I think our copper stocks, we just took them out.
Yeah, they're both below their sell lines. Yep.
Yeah. But everything else is in there. So it's a big list. And one of the things that we want to make sure that people realize is that the scores and the rankings that these stocks get is based on the date of the download, which is usually going to be sort of the day that it comes out or the day before it comes out. I think you did a download on Sunday this week and you put it out on the Monday. So before anyone makes any investment decisions based on that list, they should at least check the share price. I mean, we would recommend do all your own research and get your own scores. But if you're not going to do that, at least check that the share price hasn't gone up dramatically before you buy it. Well, if it goes down, it makes it probably a better score, doesn't it? Unless it's gone down too much.
Well, if it drops below its sell line, it's not a buy.
Unless it's crashed since you get it. So, you know, do some basic checks, obviously, before you make any investing decisions.
Yeah, and also too, we've left in stocks regardless of whether they have fresh numbers or we're still waiting for some numbers to come through. So be aware of that. And I think the last thing is that it's always a choppy time to buy stocks as they go ex-dividend around this time. So probably I've started going ex-dividend the last week or so, and I'll keep doing it for another couple of weeks. So just be careful of that, because that can throw your timing out, and you may need dividends or you may not want them. So just be aware of that. And also too, if a lot of stocks or some stocks are sailing close to their sell lines, if they drop down, add the dividend back to that, at least until the dividend's paid. Mm-hmm. So you can make a better decision. And I'm usually pretty forgiving of a stock that falls just below its sell line at this stage of proceedings, because in some cases, not only are they going ex-dividend and dropping by that amount, but there are plenty of funds out there who just dividend harvest and you know, we'll move on to the next dividend paying stock, and I'll be selling the stock as well. So there is some extra downward pressure, which doesn't last very long usually.
Right.
And the stocks will bounce back.
Just want to point out for people listening to the free episodes, in the newsletter that we send out to the free listeners, I think you'll get two stocks out of that list. We'll probably put out a small cap stock, the top small cap stock and the top large cap stock, depending on where your level of investing is in your portfolio. But for the club members, you're going to get the full list, which I think today was like 90 stocks in that list.
Yeah.
It's a big list. Yeah.
It is, Very much so. Interestingly enough, I went through it on the weekend too, and if you do filter out companies that haven't given us their June half numbers, and you filter out the iron ore companies and copper companies, and you filter out those which so far this month have trended down, which I tend to do as well, the list gets much shorter.
Yeah.
Yeah. But as I say, I think the downward pressure this month is probably going because of stocks going ex-dividend, and it'll turn around.
Right. So you left the Josephines in the list?
What's a Josephine again?
Where they've trended down. They're above their buy line, but they're trending down.
Yes, I've left it in. Correct. So,
well, okay. Well, that's controversial.
Well, that's what I said. We can put out a very short buy list, but then if something goes from trending down to trending up next week, the buy list is out of date, or it could change quite dramatically, quickly.
So that's why we put out a new one every week, mate.
We can do that, or we can just let people check it themselves before they decide to buy. And then they'll have a day-by-day check on it.
Yeah, but one of the points of the buy list, I think, is, you know, over the last couple of years we've been doing this, we get constantly get feedback from people who, you know, play around with QAV for a bit. They do the two-week free trial. They subscribe for a little while. And you know, they'll say, oh, listen, love it. They appreciate everything you and Tony are doing, but I just don't have time to learn it, and my Excel skills aren't good enough, and I can't afford a stock doctor subscription and this and that and the other, and I can't afford to do it. So, you know, one of the ideas of putting out this list is it's for people who don't want to do all the work themselves. It gives them a list of suggested stocks that we think are a good buy. So, you know, I think we should do all the work for them here as much as we can, so they don't have to then go and check too many things anyway. You know, I normally fail them on sentiment if they're a Josephine, based on our previous discussions. But if you think there's good reason not to do it because of the whole ex-dividend issue this week, then that's different.
No, I think the whole thing, I think that still applies. I just wanted people to make their own decision and to check the stock at the time that they were going to buy it, because if they listened to this on Friday and checking our buy list then, things may have changed in the next 4 days.
Sure.
Yeah. But I can take it out. I think I should take out the iron ore stocks and copper stocks anyway. I'll start doing that from now on.
Yeah.
It'll mean another column in the master spreadsheet, but I'll send a new one, a fresh one through to you with that in it. I'll have to add a manually entered data column to say what's the underlying commodity.
And is that commodity
in positive sentiment or not?
Yeah, right.
But that's okay. I can do that. And I can also add another column to say, is it trending down this month?
Well, should we be introducing the commodity column as standard practice now?
Yes.
Seeing as that's what we're doing? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so we need an updated version of the master checklist and the AF checklist that checks that. We need to put it in the Bible as well.
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
And then the question is, should we do that for Josephine's as well?
Well, Josephine's, I did do that for my own checklist a few weeks ago, but then I realized, well, it's just sentiment checks anyway. I mean, every time I run a checklist, I check the sentiment. So anyway, so if it goes from being a Josephine 1 week and then it spikes back up the next week, then, you know, it's sentiment goes from negative to positive.
Okay, so do you want to just use the sentiment score for Josephine's as well?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. That's what I do. Because that's what it is really, right? It's just picking up its sentiment. It's just we've added a new element to sentiment. It used to just be, is it above the buy line? But since then we've said, but if it's above the buy line, but it's been declining recently, then, you know, no, it fails. So sentiment, part B of sentiment.
Yeah, well, I guess it does fail, but it's in my mind, it's been more of a hold. Let's just keep checking it until it turns up again. But, and I think maybe we should call it out separately just so you don't get lots of questions around, hang on, this is how I draw the buy line. Why is the sentiment? It's above the buy line. You know, why is the sentiment negative? I'll put a Josephine column into the manually entered data so we can clarify it.
Okay. You can do that. I mean, look, but the problem with, like, the free listeners, I mean, quite frankly, if you listen to this for 2 weeks and you're not fully subscribed, I don't know what your problem is. Like, what are you going, I'm not sure this Kynaston guy knows what he's talking about. Really? How long is that going to take you to work out? You know, my point was going to be that they probably don't understand the system well enough to know to even check for a Josephine. So to expect them to do that is probably expecting a bit much.
Okay.
Then again, that's their fault, right? They should. It's on them if they don't know because they haven't got serious about it yet. But I don't know. Yeah. I'm in two minds.
I was too. That's why I didn't make the change before I sent through the buy list. So, but that's okay. I can do it.
Good point. Yeah. I don't know. Tell us what you think, listeners out there.
Let's get some feedback from people too. Yeah.
Nevexa, I wanted to point out, we've just eclipsed the 2 year anniversary of the portfolio, Tony.
Wow. How have we gone?
Oh, not too bad. I think since – so we have the official start date of our dummy portfolio is the 2nd of November – September 2019 because that's when we invested all of our fake startup capital that we started with.
Yep.
Since then, in that two-year period, the ASX 200 is up roughly 10%. And we're up roughly 37%.
That's 10% per annum and 37% per annum. That's our compound growth, yeah? We're up more than 37%. We're up 50% because we started at $20,000 and now we're at $30,000.
Is it really?
Yeah. It's 30% compound growth and versus 10% for the ASX.
See, that's why you get paid the big bucks, Tony, is you
just for paying attention.
Well, you just don't look at a graph and go, okay, I guess that's what it is. Oh, yeah, of course. Well, that makes a lot more sense. Wow. So 37% per annum. Holy shit. That's impressive. Mm. Wow.
That's why our subscribers have been posting those big numbers in the leaderboard.
I was happy with the fact that we're up 37% over 2 years, but we're up 37% a year over 2 years.
So we started with $20,000-odd, and then what's the portfolio value now? 30-something?
Yeah, 31, 32.
Yeah, so it's up 50% in the last 2 years, which is 30% compound growth.
37? Yeah, really?
That sounds high, actually. No, that's not right. I get to 37,000, so there's something wrong there.
Hey, folks, Cameron in the editing room. To cut a long story short, Tony and I couldn't work it out, and I emailed the guys at Nivexa, and Navar Trousselot, the CEO of Nivexa, sent me an email saying, Hey, Cameron, I'll explain. The calculation doesn't just take the starting value and the ending value of the portfolio and determine the performance. It individually calculates the performance on every stock in the portfolio, including the time that each stock and each position within the stock was invested in order to calculate the overall return. The annualization is also not as simple as counting the days between the 1st of September 2019 and the 7th of September 2021. The annualization calculates the number of days each stock position was open for in the portfolio and sums them together to get the average years invested, or AYI. It is the AYI that is then used to annualize the return. This gets even more complex if you have stocks with multiple open and closed positions, but all of that is handled. So the 36.53% is made up of all of the above. If you wanted to calculate it by hand, you'd need to calculate the performance of each individual stock and also calculate the AYI for each individual stock and then combine them. This calculation is essentially a big reason Nivexa exists, in that it brings a professional level calculation methodology to the everyday investor. And then he says they have a page on their website that explains how it all works if you want more details. Now, of course, I can't make any sense of that. It just melted my brain. But I've asked Tony to maybe explain it in English for us on the show next week. Hope that helps. Well, either way, it looks like our portfolio is doing well.
It
exactly
is.
How well compared to the All Ords, we don't know, but good. It's good. It's four times, somewhere in that vicinity maybe.
Yeah, saying three times at the moment,
right?
Depending on what they're measuring there.
Yeah. Okay, your pulled pork this week, Tony. What is it?
Yeah, pulled pork this week is Clearview Wealth.
Oh, no. Do I own them? Should I sell now before we do this?
I hope you do, I know, because they're doing well.
I don't. No. I think I did at one point.
Really? Mm. I'm glad you sold them. That's why they're doing well, probably.
Thanks. Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah. And they're up 8% today, which is Monday the 6th of September.
Right.
In fact, they're climbing very quickly. So what's happened? So Clearview Wealth is a company that it's a financial services company, mm-hmm. basically a life insurance provider or a seller of life insurance. Mm. But it also has two other arms to it, its businesses. It has a wealth management business and a financial advice business. And I think the reason why the share price is taking off is because they've just announced they're going to sell the financial advice part of their business. They're still retaining a stake in the company that's buying it.
Yeah.
And it's also a financial advice business, and then it's being merged together with them. But I think, you know, people are happy that the company is basically a life insurance business and the other financial advice wasn't adding a whole heap to the company's profits.
Right.
So that's why it's been, that's why the share price has taken off since that announcement, which came out with the annual results. And just a bit of background on that, even though the directors only look like they hold about 4% of the capital for the company, there is a large shareholder on the register called Crescent Capital who own 54%. So Crescent Capital are an investment company, and they are conducting a strategic review with the board on what this company looks like going forward. And this is the sort of first outcome from that review, which is to get rid of the financial advice business and to concentrate on the other two, particularly life insurance. So that's what's happening with the company, but it scores really well. The QAV of 0.4, and this is based on a 61 cent share price, which it was this morning. It's now up to about, it's up to more than that. It's up to
66.
66. Yep.
I sold them for 50.
Well done.
Back in June. It's 21st of June. Bought them
at 50. Sell low.
So I bought them at 50, sold them at 50. I think it was a rule one thing. They went up, they went back down, and I sold them.
Okay.
And then they went up. God damn it.
Bugger.
Bastards.
Yeah, so the QAV score is good, 0.4. Average daily trades, pretty small, 27,000, and that's largely because of that large shareholder on the book, so there's not much free float. Quality score is a little bit low, 56%, but then if you take into account that, okay, it's not a founder owner that has a large shareholding, but there is a vested interest there with a large shareholding, which I've never taken into account before, but it seems to be having a positive impact. So maybe the quality score is a little bit understated there. But anyway, price to operating cash flow are very low, 1.4 times, PE of 3, net tangible assets of 70 cents per share, or we use NEPS, which is 73 cents per share. So it's trading less than its net tangible asset value, which is another great thing to be aware of in terms of valuation. Consensus valuation, I think there's only one stockbroker covering it, but they've got 96 cents as the price. Sure. The growth forecast is down, so that may have been depressing the share price, and that may change after this sale of the financial advice part goes through. What else can I say? It's not a star stock, but it does have strong financial health from Stock Doctor. It's not the highest or lowest of the last six PEs. It's in the middle. And I've got it down as a new three-point upturn. It's been trading in and out for a while now, but it was a sell recently and came back into being a buy since the latest uptick in the share price. Equities hasn't been consistently increasing, so it gets a zero for that. So that's the pulled pork. General advice only, as we have to say after our AFS license came through.
For every stock? We have to say that
I think we're supposed to say it as often as possible, but anyway.
Right.
General advice only. Do your own research. Scores well and the share price is taking off, so have a look.
Mm. Very good. ASG, Tony. It's crossed the sell line.
Just a couple of more comments on stocks I came across doing a buy list on the weekend. ASG, which is Auto Sports Group, has been on our buy list in the past, and I think it may even still be on it. I think it's just crossed its sell. I'll just double check that again today because it's gone up a little bit today. Yeah, it's right on the sell line today, I think. Let me have a look. No, I think it's just crossed its sell line. I'm getting very close. I'm getting around 225, and maybe it's a cent above the sell. Yesterday it was just below. It's gone up a percent today, but it's right on the sell. So I wanted to call that out. Be aware of ASG if you're holding it. It's awfully close to a sell if it isn't today.
Right. And VER.
No, I'm sorry. I think it's what's it called? VRS.
Oh, Verus. Okay.
I put in the wrong code in our show notes, sorry. And again, I think this was on the buy list in the past. Maybe not. Let me just have a look.
Yeah, it sounds familiar.
Yeah, I think it was. I'm just going to check its QAV score. Yeah, so it currently has a QAV score of 0.19 based on its latest figures. However, it came out with a qualified audit, so I just want to double-check that one again.
Oh, Verus, Geospatial Services. Yeah, I know these guys from my old consulting days. They were competitor to one of my consulting clients. That's why I know them.
Oh, right. Okay.
Do a lot of LIDAR scanning and all the cool stuff that surveyors are doing these days.
Yeah, that's right. It's a surveying company, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to find the wording I'm after. Oh. Oh, this is another one that's coming through. I've got this wrong again. How can that be? I can't see the qualified audit now.
Wow. How many Negronis were you drinking yesterday?
I haven't had a drink in like 2 weeks.
A drink at all?
Correct. I should get back on the drinks. I'll make better sense.
Who are you and what have you done with Tony Kynaston?
Why can't I find that going concern?
Because you're sober. That's the problem. What? You told me
no,
you...
No, but I found it yesterday. It was last night.
You said you bought all this new whiskey Nikko and you were doing a couple of glasses a night. What happened?
I just stopped for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to get healthy, trying to lose some weight.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, so look, there is a... okay.
There's no calories in whiskey, Tony. It's well-established scientific fact.
No, it's actually
I heard it on Sky News.
No, just taking a break. Feel much better for it, actually, too. Got to say. Oh,
good for you.
Yeah. Okay, so there is a going concern in the, notes to the financial statements. Note 6, going concern. This is raised by the directors rather than the auditors. The group recorded a loss from continuing operations of $1.38 million. The net cash inflow from activities was $6.7 million, including $5.1 million of JobKeeper receipts.
JobKeeper.
The directors are pursuing a demerger of Acura, A-Q-U-R-A, from the Verus Limited Group, through a potential IPO subject to regulatory requirements. This demerger is expected to raise additional capital to fund the company's cash flow budgets. So that's what that raised the red flag for me, Cam. I'm surprised that the auditors haven't picked it up too. I'm just going to check that audit report again.
So it sounds to me like you're searching for going concern in these documents, finding it and going, yep.
Yeah,
it's not actually a qualified audit. It's just the directors calling out some cash flow issues.
Yeah, possibly. It's I'm sorry. I don't know why I didn't look at the audit report correctly. Maybe that's what I did, search for going concern and found it. Strictly speaking, not a qualified audit. However, let me just see if it's called out in the audit. Yeah, it is. It's a key audit matter. Yeah, so the auditors have raised it as a key audit matter. They haven't really made an emphasis of matter. And they've called in other people with more experience to have a look at it, and that's pretty much all they've said.
Right.
But
sounds like enough to make it a red flag.
Certainly convinced me yesterday when I was doing my analysis, but strictly speaking, it's not, so I want to make that clear. However, if you're relying on JobKeeper and or decoupling a part of the business and floating it as an IPO to raise money to keep going, it's doesn't sound like you've got the strongest business in the world, does it?
Mm-hmm. No, but they might have after that. Depends on, maybe they're...
Yeah, I don't want to be... I'm pretty negative on it based on that, but I don't want to be categorically negative. But, I guess I have been. I put it down as a qualified audit myself.
All right. Speaking of JobKeeper, I hear Jerry Harvey decided to give back...
He did.
..a third of the JobKeeper money that he got.
$6 million worth.
Out of $22 million or something.
A record profit year for him.
Yeah. What a nice guy.
Yeah, thanks, Jerry.
Before we move on.
As a taxpayer, thank you very much.
Yeah. Before we move on to questions, I just wanted to ask about MXI. Somebody in Facebook asked about MXI last week, stock that I do hold. It had this 5-for-1 consolidation. And then it sort of has disappeared since then. Stock Doctor and also my stocks app aren't showing me any price changes in the last week or so. Now, somebody said that it was now the code had changed to MXIDA, but you said that was just like a holding pattern
or something.
Yeah, it's
temporary. So if you have a stock doctor now, MaxiTrans is there, but yes, everything is flipped over to the 5x consolidation. So the share price is now $3.65, whereas before the share price, last time we looked at it, was around 70 cents.
Yes.
And what happens during the interim is that the share code gets given the suffix DA after it, so MXIDA, which is a fairly common thing for anything which is undergoing a restructuring. And it just means because of T+2 settlement, it makes people aware that if they buy shares at 70 cents today, that they may be worth, and they will be worth $3.50 tomorrow, or in 2 days' time. So it's just they use that DA to say it's, I think it's officially called a deferred settlement, but it may even hold up settlement by more than the T+2 days while they get all the data to flow correctly and reflect the new share price. But that's what it is.
Oh, and I just realized looking in Stock Doctor that they issued a trading halt last week. Pending some, that and the completion of the sale of their trailer business, maybe, and they're supposed to come out of the trading halt on the 7th of September. We're recording this on the 6th, so that's why it's been flatlining for the last week.
Right, okay. Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
Right, so we should see the – because I last time I looked at it, I was like, oh, the share price hasn't moved in a week. That's weird, and there's been no trading, but that's why it's got a trading halt. Should have thought of that earlier.
Hmm.
Okay. Thank you for that. Right. Into questions. Daniel.
Yeah, it's only been going for an hour.
Yeah.
Because I thought we had two questions and so I padded.
Oh, is that what you did? Oh, okay. Well, sorry about that. Daniel asks, CVW has now entered the top of the list. Was hoping for some help with the balance sheet and cash flows. I've noticed in the last couple of years their operating cash flows jumped up substantially to previous years and, in effect, makes them come out with a nice QAV score. I'm wondering if Tony could shed some light as to what's behind this. It has a pretty poor quality score relative to other high scores on the list. It's taken on more debt in the last couple of years, which sounds counterintuitive if it's operating well, and directors only have a small stake, which concerns me a little. I've noticed by sentiment, though, it's looking as if it's turned around and trending upwards nicely, which makes me think I'm missing something. He did send me this question last Monday, and I didn't see it until after we'd recorded, and then it went up by 15%. So I apologize for that, Daniel. I was meant to send you the question to get a private email response, but I got busy with AFSL legal documentation, and so my apologies, Daniel. We've already talked about CVW. Is there anything else you want to add based on Daniel's question?
Yeah, just a couple of points. So the operating cash flow for this company looks like it's almost completely driven by the life insurance business. So the receipts from customers are basically life insurance premiums. And when I say life insurance, I mean life insurance and other products in that suite. So income protection, for example, would also be a life insurance product. So it's all, the operating cash flow is dominated by the life insurance business. Lots of money coming in from the receipts from customers. And then the major outgoing is claims on life insurance policies. So the big change in recent times looks like that the premiums have gone up slightly over time, but the claims have come down. And that's been a big driver in the operating cash flow going up. And I'm talking broad brushes here. There's some other movements in there as well, but that's pretty much what it is. So there was a question about why the operating cash flow had jumped up substantially in previous years. That's the reason. I don't know why the claims are going down and whether that will continue. Sometimes insurance companies can get big benefits by tightening up some wording in their policies and pay less claims, for example, but I'm not sure if that's the case here or if it's just something else going on. So premiums up, claims down, big tick for insurance companies, and that's a big driver of the operating cash flow. Uh, the The wouldn't say that 56% was a poor quality score. And I think, as I said before, even though management only hold 4% of the company, the Crescent Capital holds over 50% and they have a representative on the board. So there is a lot of committed capital in the business, which I think is a good thing, which isn't reflected in our quality score. In terms of taking on more debt, I didn't see that when I had a look at the numbers. I couldn't see where debt was increasing, not markedly anyway. It might have been up by 5% or something. The Stock Doctor score is still financially strong, so their metrics don't, or their analysis don't consider the debt to be a problem. And I'm also wondering whether, again, it's kind of an accounting thing for life, a company that issues life insurance policies, because they will have to back up those policies with collateral, so that if they're to allow payments to be made on the claims, and that could be funded by issuing bonds, for example. So it could be, and there are government regulations around how much capital you have to pay. And just in summary, the way that works is that if I start a life insurance business tomorrow, I'll start taking premiums in this year, and I'll have claims potentially even from day two, which I have to fund. And if the premiums don't allow me to fund that, like say there's a big claim early on, the government says I have to have a certain amount of collateral held to pay those early claims until you get to a stage where the premiums are funding the claims liability. So that could be why the company was issuing or taking on debt, probably by issuing bonds, I would have thought, to hold the collateral to pay out claims on the life insurance policies.
Yeah, I'm looking at their balance sheet in Stock Doctor. Long-term debt under non-current liabilities, December 16, zero, June 17, zero, December 17, zero, June 18, zero, December 18, 15 million. Then it goes 15 million, 34 million, 61 million, 91 million, and 103 million.
Sorry, whereabouts are you in Stock Doctor for this?
Balance sheet, financial statements, balance sheet under non-current liabilities. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Everything else looks like it's tracking pretty normally, but there has been an increase in long-term debt over the last 3 years.
Long-term debt. Sorry. Now I can see it. Yeah. What I looked at when I made that statement before was the headline number for non-current liabilities. So
yeah, it hasn't changed dramatically.
It hasn't changed much at all.
Because they've got billions. They've got $2 billion in non-current liabilities.
Yeah, which I'm guessing, again, is collateral being held for claims for the life insurance business.
Yeah.
And that's gone from, since December 19, from $2 billion up to nearly $2.3 billion now, which is an increase but not a huge one. And when you're talking about this half, $100 million worth of long-term debt, it's not a big part of that number.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I don't see that line item increasing as being a big issue, really.
I think claims are down, by the way, just because people have been locked in their houses for the last year.
Quite possibly.
They're wearing masks and washing their hands three times a day with disinfectant, So.
Yeah, well, it's entirely possible. So it may reverse when we come out of lockdown.
I know that's why they're saying there were no deaths from influenza after about recorded after like June last year.
Really?
In Australia, yeah, last time I looked, because everyone was in lockdown for winter and PPEing and washing their hands and influenza deaths just stopped in their track. There's normally like thousands of them and they just disappeared.
I know we can't continue in lockdown forever, but I do hope that means that we keep going with some of the things we've learnt, during COVID to keep that influenza death rate down, whether it's QR tracking and wearing masks or whatever.
Well, Chrissy was,
I don't know what it is.
Chrissy was telling me this morning, she's just decided she's just going to always wear masks in public, in shopping centres and places like that. She goes, yeah, that's no big deal. And I like the fact that I'm, lessening my chance of getting sick and passing on sicknesses to others. So I'm just going to keep doing it regardless of what the law says.
Yeah, that's what I do too. I like that fact as well. It's taught you a lot about hygiene, hasn't it, COVID?
I tell you what I like. I like most about it is I don't have to see people's faces when I'm out in public. I like that. I'm all for that. Like, just everyone cover up as much as possible. I don't want to have to look at you. It's just no.
I know whenever I feel low and feel down, which doesn't happen much about myself, I used to go and sit in the front door of Chadston and watch the people go past, and it cheered me up. I felt better about myself.
So you just look in your bank account, do dude. Don't just look in your bank account. Go, yeah, I'm all right. Yeah. Doing okay? That's no good.
I have noticed I like wearing it. Like I didn't realize that like most communications I had with people as I was walking through a building or down the street was a smile and a nod.
Yeah.
And now that doesn't register. So you've got to actually say, oh, hello to people and actually say something to them. Just to be polite.
Don't have to. You just get a mask with hi, how are you? Written a smile. Yeah. A tip of the hat. You got to bring back the old tip of the hat, Tony. You just tip the hat as you went past.
Yeah.
Eric asks, hi, Cam. Hope you're well. I am. Thank you, Eric. I've made an observation on commodity stocks, says Eric. It seems to me that there were two states when it comes to commodity price charts. One, when the commodity price is moving up or down, and secondly, when prices are consolidating sideways. When the price is consolidating, commodity stocks seem to behave like regular stocks, and stocks going up or down are triggered by news of ore discoveries, increased volumes, etc. But when commodity prices move, this seems to override any other aspect of a company as it directly affects the sale of the metal and hits the revenue directly. I've limited experience, have only done QAV for 6 months, but based on recent trend events like the end of the iron boom, we should be using commodity price as a proxy for share price. When prices go up, jump on the best scoring QAV stock for that commodity. Sell when price trend ends or goes sideways. And due to the speed that prices move, as we saw with the iron price decline, a shorter time frame seems warranted. I'm looking at weekly charts using the last 2 years. Would be interested in your thoughts. Cheers, Eric. Eric the Alpha B.
Eric the Alpha B. So that's another question you just slipped in there. You didn't even email me that one.
I did email you that one.
No, you didn't?
Dude, I swear.
It's not there.
I swear to God. It's
next
in.
Question was from Wayne.
No, look at the email again.
Oh, okay.
Seafood.
Sorry, you're right.
It was in there.
Okay. Yeah, all right. It is
so
there.
You need
sorry.
To get back to drinking, man. I tell you, this is not good for you. This sobriety doesn't suit you.
My eyesight's going without drinking. Eric makes some good points, and it's pretty much what we do. We use the 3-point trend lines on the underlying commodity.
We're not looking at 2-year charts, weekly charts, like he's suggesting. We're doing 5-year monthly still.
Correct, yeah. So, I mean, I don't have the answer as to whether 2-year would do better, but I know 5 years worked well for us, picking up iron ore when it was starting to boom and getting us out when it was down enough to cross its 3-point sell line.
Yeah.
And the same with gold and the same with other ones, coal.
Yeah. And like you always say, just generally with 3-point trend lines, you can do shorter time frames and daily, weekly instead of monthly, but it just means you're going to be making decisions that are perhaps more volatile, and that comes with its own problems.
Correct, yeah. Yeah, so, Eric, go for it, mate, and let us know how you go. I use a 5-year monthly for commodities, and you're absolutely right. They do drive the stocks that mine them and sell them. And not just metal stock, as we've seen with Ingham's. The poultry price has been going up. So there are other underlying commodities that we look at as well.
I thought for a second there you were saying that metal prices and Ingham's were connected. I was thinking, really? No. Do they like feed their chickens metal or what?
Yeah, you just walk into the supermarket with a large magnet and walk out with the chicken.
Just for the new QAV listeners, you just want to remind people why you use 5-year monthly as opposed to something more turbulent?
Yeah, so just experience. 5-year monthly is less volatile. I've Stock Doctor uses a 2-year weekly chart. I have used 2-year weeklies before. I have looked at moving averages over 180 days and 90 days and 30 days. They're just more volatile, and volatility can hurt you based on transaction costs and capital gains tax costs. So the less volatile, the better has been my experience, and the best, you know, ideally I'd like to hold the stock forever. So not that that happens, but we hold it for a, you want to hold it anyway for 12 months if you can and get the CGT discount that's available in Australia anyway. So yeah, I use 5-year monthly, but it's mainly around decreasing the volatility.
Right. Yeah. And the problem with volatility is that you will be selling too soon because things dip and then come back up. And when you sell, you've got capital gains tax issues, brokerage issues, and, you know, you have to go through all the effort of replacing the stock with something else that may or may not do as well as this stock and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and, you know, as we've seen in the last month, there's been a lot of rotation, at least in my portfolio, out of iron ore stocks, out of copper stocks, into other things. So it is quite a, it's a fair bit of work to do that, a fair bit of analysis to do that and to find the things to replace it with. So yeah, it's just more work, to do it on a short time period.
Yeah.
You become more like a trader rather than an investor. That's what I found anyway.
By the way, I'm, making a note for myself to email you a PDF of the notes from now on.
Okay. Oh, rather than the, Microsoft Notes, whatever it is. Is it Microsoft or?
Wash your mouth out. Soap and water, notes. Young Kyneston.
Apple
Notes. Yeah.
Apple Notes. Yeah.
I always email Tony a link to my Apple Notes, and it, for some reason the version he got today was a couple of hours out of date. So hence his complaining. Wayne asks.
I'm not complaining.
Wayne asks, Cameron, can you please ask Tony to explain the true reason a company will pay a return of capital instead of a special dividend? I suspect it is to reduce the share price to match the new expected business level. AVA is selling its services division, which is around 70% of revenue, but 35% of profit. It is proposing to pay a return of capital from the sale proceeds equal to 30% of the current share price. I assume this will result in a drop in share price of a similar amount. Should this be of any concern, or is it just a management tactic used when there are no franking credits available? Really enjoy the show. Regards, Wayne.
Thanks, Wayne. I think it was probably a multi-pronged reason for this. Certainly return of capital usually reflects the fact that there isn't franking credits to hand out. Otherwise, it would be a special dividend, which would come fully franked. In terms of some of the other questions you've asked, though, the reason for the sale and return of capital is often important. And it looks like in this case with AVA, management are saying it's a non-core part of their business. It looks like when this company started life as a separate company, it was spun out of another company called MaxSec, and it looks like that the business that AVA is now divesting is a legacy of that spin-off when it was rolled out of MaxSec. So it makes sense if it's a non-core business. It looks to me, you know, I don't know the company very well, looks to me like the company is a technology company providing monitoring services, and the company that it, the part of that company that they're selling, the legacy business, looks more like it's a security business. So it doesn't have a technology component to it, or much of a technology component to it. So I kind of get why they're doing it. I suspect, I don't know, but I suspect that the company may re-rate. I don't know the company in detail, but if it, for example, is seen as a technology company, like a software as a service company, then yeah, it may re-rate up rather than down when the non-core business is sold off.
What does that mean?
Because it might.
What do you mean re-rate?
Yeah. So currently, the business. I don't know this business, but let's just talk hypothetically. Say it's half a security business where guys jump in cars and go around to make sure your factory hasn't been burgled, and the other half is technology that, you know, will send you a text message if your perimeter's been breached at the factory. And so if you combine those two businesses together, the valuation that's applied might be half of one and half of the other. And the guys going around in cars to check the factory business is going to have a much lower valuation metric applied to it as opposed to the software business, because the software business doesn't involve much capital, doesn't involve much employees. Is every time you get a dollar of revenue, it's going to translate to a higher profit than putting guys in cars, leasing cars, going around and shining flashlights on the factory walls for you at night. I don't know if that's the case with AVA, but I'm saying if it is, then if they get rid of the guys in cars going around to check factories, the business may increase in share price because it moves on to a higher valuation metric. And this company, for example, at the moment has an NTA of 9 cents per share, but its share price is much higher than that. So it's not being rated based on its assets. It's being rated based on a multiple of its earnings. And so even though they're giving back, I think it's about 16 cents per share, I'm not sure the share price will drop by 16 cents to match that return of capital. It may. That's the kind of logical thing that will happen. But if the company gets re-rated during that time, it may actually not drop by 16 cents. It might actually even go up. I'm not familiar with AVA to know what's happening there. But there are different things that go on with these kinds of capital returns. And it looks to me like it's selling off a business which doesn't have the kind of metrics that a software business would have and be as appealing to investors in technology companies as the other half of the business. So I think that might be a reason behind that divestment as well. And the third one, Wayne asked what the true reason for a company doing this kind of thing is. I wouldn't be surprised, and I don't know if it's the case, so I'll qualify my comments with that. I wouldn't be surprised if management are rewarded on return on equity. And the ROE for this company is currently 47%. And once it sells off this business, it gets a lot of cash in, something like $40 million or $30 million, which will sit on the balance sheet unless it's used, which will depress the ROE. So they're wanting to get that cash out the door as quick as possible, thereby decreasing the equity part of the ROE calculation and keeping it high, which is attractive both to investors but probably also to management who have incentives being paid based on ROE, I think, I suspect. So that's why it's being returned to shareholders quickly. As a general sort of rule of thumb, I'm surprised that the company hasn't found a way to deploy the cash. That's usually what management would do, is they wouldn't want to give that money back to shareholders. They'd say, hey, we've got a tech company to buy. So I'm a little bit surprised it's going back to shareholders, which lends me to think that it's an ROE play by management to keep ROE up and right, therefore attractive both to investors in the company who, as we've said time and again in the past, look at ROE. Investors will often look at a high ROE company and give it a premium in terms of its valuation. But potentially also management are also rewarded based on that ROE metric staying high.
Yeah. So bottom line is, could be a range of things, some legitimate, some a little bit sort of self-serving.
Yeah, as it usually always is.
Yeah. Well, all decisions everyone always makes.
Yeah, exactly.
Good question, Wayne. Thanks. Next one is from Mantles, a.k.a. Lee and Steve. With VUK scoring so well, how would you draw its sell line? Seems to be crossing by the QAV letter of the law, but also seems tough given it's basically a steep uptrend since the flat bottom L1 of 30 September 20 and then a recent sideways.
Yeah, so I've got the sell line. Because of the flat bottom, I've got the sell line as September 2020. And then there's a couple of troughs on the way up which that sell line then touches. So currently I'm using the last of those, which is going to be July 2021, which means it's below its sell price currently. In fact, it's June 2021. There's a trough there.
Yeah, well, that puts it after it's below its sell price.
Correct. Yeah, we sold it out of the portfolio a little while ago.
Right.
It was a sell for us. Yeah, the price. In fact, the price has dropped and it's come back up again a little bit.
Yeah.
But it hasn't come up enough to be a buy again. So, yeah, it's a sell. Yeah.
So the sell price is like $446. It's trading at $398.
What am I getting for the sell price? Yeah, I'm getting around $450-ish. I'm just doing it with the segment drawing and stock doctor to get that. Yeah.
So it scores well, but is below its sell line. So we would sell it if we owned it, and definitely not buy it. And it's also a bit of a Josephine. It closed August at $4.04. It's currently at $3.98, so just a little bit down below where it closed last month.
Yeah, and it's a funny one too. It's one of these ones which has it's kind of like a buy and sell at the same time. So
right, because well, it's a Schrodinger.
It's a Schrodinger.
Yeah,
it crossed its sell line. So then we look for a new buy line, but it's then had another sell line since then.
Yeah, so technically a Schrodinger, which for new listeners is a stock that is both a buy and a sell at the same time.
Yeah, it's above its buy line, but it's below its sell line, so we don't like touching those.
Yeah. Don't touch.
It needs to be above both.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. And essentially what it's saying to me, just looking at the graph, is that the steepness of that growth is coming out of the share price appreciation since that low point in September 2020.
Right.
It's starting to roll over a bit.
Right. Okay. Thanks, Mantles. Dave asks, could Tony have a look at Humm and why the big change in the QAV score?
Yeah, so interesting one, Humm. The big change in the QAV score is it's not on our index anymore because it has operating cash flow, which has now turned negative. So December 20 interim was a positive $230 million worth of operating cash flow, but June 21 is now negative $110 million of operating cash flow. I haven't really figured out what that change was brought about by. There's a line item in the operating cash flow in Stock Doctor, which has minus $263 million against it, and it's just listed as other operating cash flows. So I haven't had time to dive into the annual report, but I can do it quickly and have a quick look.
Another one I sold out of. I'll be
looking for a financial note to see what that is if I can.
Right.
I know that the business has changed quite dramatically from, it still is, but it used to be only a business which provided the in-store credit for purchases. So as we were saying before about Jerry Harvey, you often see on his ads interest-free for 5 years or interest-free for 3 years or 2 years or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And most of that was provided by this company, FlexiGroup. It used to be called FlexiGroup. Now it's called Humm. And as part of that change in name, they also got into the buy now, pay later space.
Mm-hmm.
So they have a product, which I think is called Humm, which also looks a bit like the Afterpay product.
And Harvey Norman doesn't need their money anymore because they just got $22 million of JobKeeper. So who needs to sell products when you just get free money from the government, right?
Well, I'm just looking at there's an announcement here saying that let's have a look. I'm just having a look at that. There's been a rebalancing of the ASX and it may have affected Humm, which is why the share price is down. Yeah, Humm's been removed from the ASX 300 list. So that would explain a little bit of a price drop
of ETFs and funds that automatically sell it.
Yes, that's right. There'll be a lot of, ETFs, which would have a mandate for ASX 300, but also investment funds as well, even if they're active. They may still have a mandate for being in large cap stocks. Okay, I've got the annual report. I'm just going to have a look at the cash flow statement quickly. If this takes too long, Cam, we'll take it on notice and come back to you with an answer.
Yeah.
Just says receivables is $211 million. I'll see if there's a note on what receivables are. Their receivables and their negative, which is interesting as well. I'm not seeing it quickly, sorry. I'll see if there's a note on receivables. Yeah, it's saying there was a decline in average net receivables over the year, but I can't imagine it was that much. It says receivables and customer loans, the fair values of receivables and customer loans are estimated by discounting the future contractual cash flows at the current market interest rate that is available to the group. So I'm wondering if they've had to discount, like if for example, there's been a big change in purchasing patterns that moved away from in-store credit cards to fund a product purchase and moved to the Afterpay style payment option. I wonder if that's caused them to have to discount their receivables because they're not going to receive as much income from the old style of the business.
Mm.
Anyway, that's just a guess. Yeah. I'm sorry, I'd have to really read this in detail before I could work out what it was.
Bottom line is they're not looking good from a QAV perspective right now, old hum.
Correct. Well, we don't have a QAV score for them because they have a negative operating cash flow. Mm. And this has been the first time they've had it that I can see, at least for quite a while. Mm. I'm going back. Nope, I've never had a negative operating cash flow line before. It's been driven by receivables, which is negative to $200 million, but I can't necessarily see what that is caused by. I'd have to read through the annual report in some detail to work it out, but that's what it is.
Right. Okay. Well, I got out of them at 97.5 cents, so happy days.
Yeah, I think they became a sell around that price for us too, didn't they?
Yeah, I think that's why I got rid of them. Last questions are from Edward. Edward's a new subscriber. Hi, mate, he writes. Just testing the three-point trend with a few of my holdings. The first one he's looking at is Collins Foods, CKF. And he asks, the three-point calculator's giving me a sell at 11.389, current share price is 12.49. I imagine that if I did this exercise before the share price hit 11.389, I should have sold the stock well.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if we get the same numbers as Edward. And first of all, well done for holding Collins Food. They've been a resounding success during the COVID lockdowns as people buy lots of Kentucky Fried Chicken and other takeaway food that Collins Food sells so well.
Mm.
But I'm getting an L1 point of September 16, which is about to roll off.
Mm.
And then the L2 I'm going to use is the COVID cough of March 2020, which gives me a sell price of sort of around $6 something, low sixes.
So just for Edward's benefit and anyone else who is new, so the basic process for drawing a three-point trend line, and a sell line in this case, is we start with the lowest trough on the five-year monthly chart, which in this case, as Tony said, is back in September 16. It'll drop off at the end of this month, but right now that is the lowest point. And the second lowest point is the one, the COVID cough of March, as you said, that Edward uses his first point. So it brings in a much lower sell price.
Yeah, so I'm just going to have a look what it will look like next month after that trough rolls off. So the low point after that is, I think, 5.11, and which means anything up to 5.51 is L1. Sorry?
Yes, 5.11 is the price. The one on May 17, is that what you're looking at?
Yes. However, with the flat bottom rule of 8%, it actually does make the COVID cough L1.
Yeah, right. Okay. Yeah, so within a few weeks, the sell line will look like the one that Edward drew.
Yeah, that's right. And it could be the case now, depending on the graph Edward's looking at. I'm not sure. I'm using Stock Doctor, which actually goes back 5 years to the day, which means that we're getting a trough at the start because there's a bit of a month before.
He's using Stock Doctor. Our graph. He's using Stock Doctor.
Okay, well, you should see it too then. Okay. Mm. Yeah. All right. So once we roll past the month, end of month, then L1 will be the COVID cough. So let's draw a line with using that.
COVID cough for new listeners is end of March 2020.
Yeah.
I don't know. Somebody suggested that at some point last year, and it just stuck. It's the COVID cough.
Yeah. So if you use that, then there would have been a sell in November 2020, and then there would have been a buy after that. So you would have had a sell, perhaps when it was referring to at $11.40 in July 2021. But because there's been a buy since then, if you look at the highest point on the graph or the highest peak on the graph is May 2021, and you can draw a line across to August 2021, it means that the sell line gets redrawn with L2 being July 2021.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's the share price is currently above the current sell price of about $11.70, I'm getting.
Mm.
Yeah.
But just run me through that again. So the previous sell line.
Yeah. So if you take the rule, which the rule for drawing sell line says take L1 as the lowest and then L2 as the second lowest. Mm. Second lowest
to trough, the right. Yeah.
Yeah. To the right, which would be November 2020. So if you draw a line through there, it was a sell in November 2020 when the share price fell below the line. However, since then, there's been a high price, the highest price on the graph, if we want to draw the most recent buy line, is May 2021 at a price of $12.60. And if I pick a point to the right, I've got, when's that? August 2021 has another buy.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, but the sell line today and the sell line 6 months ago would have had a sell price a lot lower than that. So if you had owned it 6 months ago or back even November 2020, as you said, was it 8 or 9 months ago, you wouldn't have actually sold it then, right? Because the sell price back then using the current sell line would have been around, I don't know, $5.50.
Yes, true. Good point. Yeah.
So all of this is sort of arbitrary.
Academic, yep.
Yeah. So the sell line where it is today, where it has been for the last year, is down around $5. And correct. In 3 weeks, when that L1 drops off and we start using March 2020 as L1, the L2 is where it is now, which is July. So the sell price is up around, well, now it's near just under $12. Probably in a couple of weeks, it'll be a bit higher than that because the line will go up to the right. So technically, if you had owned it for the last year, it hasn't crossed its sell line.
Mm-hmm. True. Good point.
That's why I get paid the big bucks, Tony.
But I do go through that process of drawing buy and sell lines to see where the current ones are.
Yeah, and I think that took me a long time to understand the whole buy line follows the sell line, follows the buy line kind of thing, that you have to chart it out because it moves, right?
Yeah, it does.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the second part of Edward's question is relating to a different stock, CAR. While you bring that up, he asks, what would Tony recommend I do today? I have a mind to let it run, considering the six-month chart looks bullish. I assume these are two stocks that he already owns, and we can't recommend correct. Give any personal financial advice, is. Edward. Yeah, we can tell you what the QAV rules say. You make your own decision. Carsales.com. Yeah, so
Carsales.com. It looks like Edward likes the growth stocks, the high PE stocks. So I don't think CKF or Carsales have been on our buy list maybe forever, but at least is what we've been doing it for the last 2 years.
Well, as I said, he's a new guy, so he's
getting around. No, he's doing the right thing. If he's got current holdings, he's going to trade them using the 3-point trend line and then migrate across.
Yeah.
Yeah, good.
He would have done well out of these two, though, if he's held them for a while.
Yeah, no, he has done well. So I'm getting a low point. Lowest point on the graph, again, is way back almost 5 years ago in November 2016. Maybe. What's November? Is 1036. No, it's actually January 2017 at 1027, and I'll just see what 8% above that is.
Yeah, no, I think it's the L1 is actually December 18 here.
1082 and the COVID cost. Yeah, I agree with you. December 18 at 1082. And that's for Edward's benefit. That's because it's a flat bottom. So December 18 isn't the lowest point on the graph, but it's within 8% of the lowest point on the graph. And it's it's the rightmost trough within 8% of the lowest point.
So for new listeners, including Edward, the theory, which is relatively new in QAV, we've only been doing this for a few months, is your regression testing that you did with one of our interns, Dylan, indicated that if you have a flat bottom or a flat top where you've got two prices that are within an 8% margin of each other, you should use the rightmost of those two prices as your starting point when you're drawing a buy line or a sell line.
Yes, and if I can just add, those prices don't need to be near each other on the graph. They can be a couple of years apart like they are on this one. And it's the reason for doing that research was that we were coming up with a lot of graphs that had flat lines that for either the buy or the sell line, which weren't much use to us to make a trading decision. So I was trying to find a way of drawing a less flat line, I guess. And also, too, the other thing which I guess drove my thinking was that we look at a five-year monthly graph, but sometimes these trends in stocks towards their peak or their trough occurs over a number of months. So you get like a U shape or a V shape, or an upside-down U-shape, I guess. And therefore, you know, the, what we might see is that one monthly trough may not be the, you know, the a fair indication of the shape of the graph. And so, yeah, I'm looking for when the trend sort of started or when it ended, both on a peak and a trough basis.
Right. So getting back to CAR, then again,
this does have a flat sell line.
Yeah, even when you take out the flat line, it still has a flat line because it's such a steep graph.
Yeah. So L1, as you said, December 18. L2 was March 2020, and then a sell price of around $12.30.
Yeah, currently trading at about $26. So, you know, again, getting back to Edward's question, what would you do if you owned it? Not what Edward should do, but if you owned it, and you wouldn't because it wouldn't be a QAV stock, but if you did, you just hold it, right?
Yeah, so I would trade it using the three-point trend line method, and currently it's a long way off its sell, so I'd be holding it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you, Edward. Well, that's all the questions for this week. Now we go into after time where we just talk about, you know, the mind of a rich guy. What have you been watching lately, Tony? What are you watching, listening to, reading, eating, drinking? Well, you know you're not drinking.
No, that's right. Drinking's on hold for a minute anyway. Watching mainly, I still haven't finished that book, Richard Wiser, Happy You, but I recommend it. Not listening to much music-wise, but watching Mayor of Easttown, which you recommended to me, which is fantastic.
Good show, huh? Only, what, six episodes, yeah. I think? Little mini-series? But
yeah, seven? I think it was, but yeah.
Really yeah. Powerful show, yeah.
Good show. If you're a fan of Dennis Lehane's mysteries, and they were turned into movies like Mystic River, that was the Julia Roberts' first starring show. Mystic River, it's really good. So, yeah, Kate Winslet does a great acting job in this, playing a cop with lots of family problems in the poor part of Pennsylvania in Easttown, a suburb. I think it's part of Philadelphia. I might be wrong there, but that's sort of not the most affluent part of the U.S. That's for sure.
Mm.
And all of the crime that brings, and the poverty and the family issues brought on by those two things, I guess, as well.
Mm.
But, yeah, gritty, full of twists and turns, which I like. Guy Pearce has a cameo in it, which is interesting.
Mm.
Didn't do much, I didn't think, but it was good to see an Aussie up there on the screen.
Two Aussies, actually.
Yes. What's her name? Iguri someone? I forget the name.
Anguri Rice, who plays her daughter, yeah. Thank you.
Another Aussie. Rice. I keep thinking Sigourney when I think of Anguri Rice.
Mm. Yeah, I thought she did a great job as well. I think she's from Melbourne or somewhere, or been around for a few years. I think she was in a Spider-Man film or something. And
acted really well.
Jean Smart playing Kate Winslet's mother. It's fantastic. The grumpy old alcoholic mother. She's had some great roles lately.
Yeah, was she the star of Hacks, that series that was also I watched a couple of weeks ago?
I haven't seen that. I don't know. But she was in one of the seasons of Fargo. I saw her also in Legion, sort of an X-Men spin-off thing, which was quite good. She was in the Watchmen TV series that I watched a bit of. Oh, yeah, Hacks. Right. IMDb said she was in Hacks. There you go.
Yeah. That's not bad. Like, sort of, you know, it's a 6 out of 10, but worth watching.
Yeah, right. Good. Well, I've watched a bit lately, but I tell you, the thing that I would give a shout out to is the Val Kilmer documentary.
Yeah, I saw that.
Oh, did you like it?
Yeah, it was good. Yeah.
Sad. Really, really sad.
Very sad.
Yeah. Not just because of his health issues, but just his career in general. He seems like, despite his fame and the big roles that he had and the money that he made, never was really creatively satisfied.
Mm, and the money's all gone too.
Yeah.
Looks like.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I'd seen stuff before about him. You know, he was always controversial about being supposedly difficult to work with and retiring to his ranch a lot, and how he was trying to build the artist colony there, which bankrupted him in the end, I think, from memory. It's interesting how it all turned out, because he hasn't turned out well health-wise either.
Mm.
That was a real shock, I think, to see that.
I think he had to sell the real estate to get his father out of trouble. Because his father...
But he definitely had to sell it, yeah.
Yeah. His father, according to the documentary, his father got them both into a bunch of dodgy deals, that's right. And he had to sell everything to get his father, buy his father out of jail.
Which didn't work, I don't think, from memory.
Oh, really? I don't know. Yeah, very sad. But Val Kilmer, man, like, some great films. I mean, leaving aside even, you know, Top Gun, what he's probably most famous for, which he says in the documentary he didn't even want to make, but he was contractually obliged to the studio to make it. So he gave it everything that he had. And I think Iceman was a great character in that. Heat. I think he was great with the small role that he had in Heat. He was great in the one where he played Doc Holliday, whatever that was. Yep. Armia Huckleberry. Yeah. The cowboy one. With Kurt Russell, he made a lot of and The Doors, of course. I mean, his performance is Jim Morrison's Doors. Yeah, that's great. The one. Yeah. When I showed Chrissy that, she couldn't believe that it wasn't really Jim Morrison. And he did his own singing in the film too, which was stunning. Like, his ability to channel Jim Morrison was fantastic.
Yeah. And good on Oliver Stone for giving him the chance. Do you remember that was controversial as well? That Val Kilmer was going to carry a film again after all his problems.
Right.
Yeah.
I also watched the first couple of episodes of the new Steve Martin, Martin Short comedy, Only Murders in the Building, which is about podcasters. As I said to you earlier today, when I started podcasting in 2004, if you'd told me that within 15, 16 years people would be basing entire big-budget TV shows with Steve Martin and Martin Short about a bunch of podcasters, so people making a podcast, I would have been – I would not have believed it. It was a scrappy little thing. There was about five of us making podcasts at the time, and it was cutting edge. There you go.
Yeah, right. Like that old joke about having the first fax machine.
Yeah,
can't wait for someone to buy the second one.
I've been listening to the Osmonds, believe it or not. I married a woman from Utah, and she never told me about the Osmonds. I mean, I knew who Donnie and Marie were, but I didn't know that the band that Donnie was in when he was a kid actually kicked some ass they put out a couple of albums in the early 70s, which are just fantastic. Sort of, they started off as like a boy band, Christian, nice rock group, right, pop group sort of thing. And then when they got old enough, they sort of reinvented themselves when they were late teens, early 20s, and sort of channeled, it's sort of a bit Jackson 5 with some Bee Gees and a little bit of Deep Purple thrown in, bit of heavy funk, really grooving tunes, and a little bit of Zappa in there as well. It's crazy.
Still very cheesy looking guys though, aren't they?
They were wearing Elvis jumpsuits and stuff, channeling a bit of Elvis too, a bit of brass. Very good looking Mormon boys with big white teeth and the whole thing. But the songs rock, man, and they actually really played the instruments. They wrote them. So I went down this Osmond's doll last week. Chrissy can't believe that I'm listening to the Osmonds. She's like shocked, her Mormon heritage coming back. But check out their, they've got an album from 1972 called Crazy Horses. Have a listen to that, man. There's a couple of really great tracks that blew my mind.
Okay. Interesting. All I think of when I think of Diane Marie is I went to Pittsburgh once around Christmas time when I first moved to Canada, so maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago, and there was these big promotional billboards up for the Donny and Marie Christmas show, which comes to Pittsburgh every year, and they looked old.
Yeah, well, that's what happens. And I've been reading.
Oh, hey, look, sorry. I was going to say, before I forget, Mr. In Between, the Australian criminal series, really, really good.
What's it about?
It's on Foxtel. So it's about there's a guy, a bit like The Sopranos, a guy who runs a strip club. He hires a bouncer who's also eventually becomes a hitman, like an enforcer. It's just about, he's in between, like living a normal family life and then going out and killing people. Breaking their legs or whatever to collect money.
Right.
It's really well made. It's fantastic acting. Scripts are great.
I'm just looking at it.
It's on Foxtel. It was sold to the FX network in America, so
right. It's
probably on some other streaming channels. Made by Nash Edgerton, one of the Edgerton brothers. The other interesting factoid for me is one of our friends had her house used as the set of one of the episodes too, which was fun to watch on TV.
I'm just looking at it on IMDb. I see that Damon Herriman is in it. One of my favorite Australian actors. He plays a character called Freddy in it. He's in 26 episodes, apparently. Yeah. He played Charles Manson in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Oh, okay.
But he was also in Justified, which a lot of people, and that's where Quentin knew him from, actually, and got him from Justified, the Timothy Oliphant show. But he was also in one of my favorite shows of the last few years, Perpetual Grace Limited. Have you checked that out yet?
No.
Ben Kingsley? Oh, man. Check it out. Great show. Just really, only ran for one season, but it was just really, really good. Jimmy Simpson, Jackie Weaver, and Ben Kingsley, and Damon Herriman. Okay. Yeah. Really, really clever writing, a little bit surreal. Good stuff. Well, that's After Hours for this week, After Time, for anyone who's interested. What are you cooking tonight, Tony?
We're going to get probably a lamb backstrap and some veggies.
Nice.
Mediterranean diet.
When do you go out to dinner next?
Oh, God. Never. Christmas.
Oh, well.
If you listen to the epidemiologists, we might make Christmas Day, but they're not hopeful. If you listen to the Premier, next month we'll all be out of lockdown and things will be eased and vaccine rates are going great. But the scientists are saying no. And given that Norman Swan said we'd be here till Christmas, he's the money guy at the moment. He's looking right.
And he said that 3 months ago, and we went, no, no way.
Oh, when the lock, it's right, when the lockdown first started, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all a bit depressing when you think about it that way. But anyway, we're good.
You're alive, you're healthy, that's what matters.
Correct, yes. I can still talk to people on Zoom and catch up and all that stuff, so that's second best, but that's good.
All right, mate. Well, nearly 2 hours again this week when we had only two questions as of 9 o'clock this morning, so there you go.
Plus we had a business meeting on Zoom this morning, which was three quarters of catch up and talking about after hour stuff.
Well, you're welcome. You get good. Talk to people. All right. Take care, mate.
All right. Thank you. Bye.
The producers of this podcast would like to remind you that we're providing general financial advice only. If you're looking for personal financial advice or before you make any investment decisions, please consult a professional financial advisor.